Yes, thanks for coming here today. My name is Hugo Kiiski. I work here at Smartly as a software developer, like Otto mentioned, on the video templating team. So our goal is to automate our customers' video creation at scale. Today I'll be talking about how we went about splitting our React codebase and what were our experiences while doing that. Let me first start off with some background on why we would want to do this. At Smartly, one of our main offerings is the image templates tool. This allows you to take any static image and apply some other data like prices and discount percentages on top of it, making it more appealing. And this is a really popular tool of ours. We render like millions of images per minute or something like that. And a year ago or so, we thought that it would also be nice to do this for videos. So there on the right, you can see what a video template looks like when Drive works. So we take some static assets and make those into a video. And when we started looking at this new feature, we had some initial requirements in mind. First of all, the Smartly tool is built for the browser, so the editor should also be running in the browser, as the customer would expect. And the video that you have in the editor while you work at it should match the rendered video as closely as possible. We also need support for complex animations, and the customers need to be able to use existing video assets that they might have in their templates. And while we are talking about automating the creative process, this needs to be scaled very well, so we are talking at least about a million of videos. And last but certainly not least, it needs to be fast to develop. We are not a video editing company, it is only one part of our tool, and we have very limited resources to put into this. So keeping these limitations in mind, we came to the conclusion that the rendering, both in the browser and in the backend, should be implemented with web technologies, so we can use the same renderer for the frontend and for the backend. There's a couple of technologies that we could use for this. We decided to go with the DOM. So what that means is that we have just basic DOM elements like divs and videos and images and so on that we animate with JavaScript and CSS. And this is great for a couple of reasons. First of all, the DOM APIs are very complete. There's lots of things that it already supports, and everyone is familiar with the APIs. So there's practically no learning curve. And also, styling is very important for videos. And CSS has lots of complicated features, such as blending modes and even 3D transforms that you could use for crazy animations. Now, the most obvious issue with this approach is that it's slow to render. You have to somehow get a picture of the DOM, and there is no native APIs to do that, of course. Some other technologies that we considered were WebGL, which you could potentially render with like an OpenGL rendering engine, so it would be very fast, but on the other hand, it requires knowledge of like graphical programming that we did not have in the team, so it was not a realistic option. Also, we could have used Canvas, using the Canvas get image data for fast image access, but it's still not on the level of DOM. You still need some framework driving the drawing and animating, and at some point you're probably going to end up modifying the framework and all kinds of fun stuff that's going to take time. So our setup became that we have the video canvas which does the rendering both in the browser and in the backend, built with TypeScript, React and GreenSock for animations. And like I said, it's shared between the frontend and the backend, which we call the reindeer, because it sounds like render. And the reindeer then loads this video canvas in a headless Chrome. And then we instruct the video canvas with Chrome Remote Debug Protocol API to seek to a specific point of time. And then we take a screenshot of the Chrome window with that same API. And after that, we combine these screenshots with FFmpeg to videos. Now, some of you are probably thinking that this is absolutely insane, and you're out of your mind, you shouldn't be doing this. And maybe I would agree with you if it wouldn't work very well for us. So we've rendered about 4 million videos or so in past half year, so it's definitely not at the scale of image templates yet, not even close. We only have like 50 rendering nodes for video templates right now, while with image templates we have like 1,000. But I'd say that it still suffices as a proof of concept. And using this approach really has allowed us to keep the video templates development speed very high. And we have practically spent no time on the renderer side itself. We have been able to put all of our effort to the editor, which is what the customers actually care about. And we still have some ideas for optimization if needed, but I'll save those for another talk. So how we actually share this code between the front end and the back end is like so that we have a master repository for all video templates related code except for the back end. So we might have code in there for the editor, for the template and the canvas and resource loading and all kinds of stuff. And that is split in built with a learner multi-repo. So if you don't know what learner is, it basically allows you to have multiple NPM repositories under one project, and then you can have dependencies between those, and learner will handle all of those. And as a side note, if you're doing this yourself, yarn link is very useful in dev environment as it allows you to link the dependencies locally without publishing them. When we actually want to use these in production, we publish them to our private NPM repository, which we use Gemfire for that. And you should also note that Reindeer is written in Node and TypeScript, so we are able to reuse lots of code from the front end. For instance, we have the video template types are all shared between the front end and the back end, so we don't redefine types and they are always up to date. Potentially in the future, we could even use something like IOTS to provide runtime type checking for our back end. But in addition to sharing code between the front end and the back end, we also share code between front end repositories. So like I said, all the video editor front end code is in one repository, and then we have like the main Smartly front end repository. We, in addition to that, also have a Smartly UI repository, which contains generic UI components that are used both by the editor and the main Smartly frontend. So here's what the video editor repository looks like. You have lots of packages here, and each package can define its own dependencies in its own package.json and have all kinds of configuration related to that package only, and then you can have also dependencies on the like global level, for instance, for test running. And so editor can, for instance, depend on the video canvas and video fonts packages, and then learner will handle all the dependency resolving, like building video canvas and video fonts before building video editor. So let's talk a bit about the advantages of this approach. Obviously, it is great if you are able to share the code between the front end and back end. You don't want to redefine the types twice if you already have them somewhere. But there are also lots of advantages to doing this on the front end, even though you could technically have everything in the same repo and import from there. We have found out that this approach has allowed us to have much faster development speed while developing the video editor, because the Smartly app is already quite old in front-end standards, 5 years or so. So it has lots of features and the bundles are quite big, so it takes somewhat long to load and to build. And when we split the video editor to its own repo, we are basically starting from scratch, so it's as fast as it could be. And that practically leads to everything related to development being faster. You have faster uploads, you have faster bundles, you have faster tests, you have faster CI. Everything is just smoother. And another big point about this splitting, in my opinion, is that it allows you to mirror your organization structure. For example, we have the video templating team, so we can split the front end packages to a video editor package, and then the video template team can own that repository completely. So there's great sense of ownership. What can happen easily if you have a big repository with like 50 people working on it, that some things become no one's problem. No one is taking ownership of the build process, for example, and when that breaks, then you scramble to find somehow someone who's going to fix it. But in our video editor repository, where we have like 5 devs working on it, I feel like everyone can work on everything, and everything is everyone's responsibility. And at Smartly, we are also big believers of the self-organizing teams. And I believe that this ties really well with that also, as the teams are able to build the dev environments that best fit the team without affecting the other teams. It also allows you to experiment with new technologies. As an example, when we were starting the video editor project, the main Smartly frontend was written in flow typed, and we didn't really like flow in the team, so we wanted to use TypeScript. And if we were to implement the video editor inside the same repo with TypeScript where you have flow, that's like the worst case I can imagine. So you have these different types that aren't compatible with each other and so on. But if we have this another repo where there's only us working basically, where we can isolate TypeScript project, it works out fine. And as it turns out, TypeScript is great. Everyone loves TypeScript, and now we are starting to adopt it more throughout the Smartly organization. And as one more point, it also, when you split things into these modules, it forces you to think about the interfaces between the modules. So you need to think about what data my module uses and what it modifies and so on, similar to microservices. And that's why this approach is sometimes called front-end microservices, but that's a bit too buzzwordy for me, so I didn't go for that in my talk. So I mentioned earlier that each team can build their own dev environments, and this is what our teams looks like. So we are using the Storybook library, which allows you to list all the React components that you have in your repository, and you can work on each of them individually. And then we have this master story for the editor, which has all of the components combined basically. And this is also the component that we export to the outer world. And yes, this is very fast compared to the main Smartly frontend, since it only has the editor related code. So at some point comes the time when you need to leave your wonderful video editor bubble and you need to integrate the thing to the main frontend. And I had a couple of points that I wanted to bring out that we decided when we were designing the video editor module. We decided that the video editor would not define its own API calls inside the package. Instead, it will take all Redux action creators or whatever as props from the main frontend. This allows the main frontend to be always in charge, and it makes it very easy to reason what the video editor module does. Similarly, the video editor does not access the main Redux store of the main frontend. It has its own Redux store embedded inside the video editor component for the same reasons. It can't mess up the main frontend's Redux store. And the side effect of this is that when you don't define any API functions and instead take them as props, it's very easy to mock them in tests and in the dev environment. So for example, in the Storybook environment that I showed, we don't actually have any real API calls. They are all just mocks. This is what that looks like in code. So this is from the main Smartly frontend repository. We import the video editor from our private NPM repo and then make a wrapper component that passes it all these resources that the video editor requires. And you can see from this that it makes it really easy to see what the video editor will actually do. There's no black box. So, like many things in software engineering, this doesn't come for free. There are some disadvantages. When you have these multiple systems, like separate repositories and separate CIs and separate teams working on them, they might have different practices, different libraries. It will become harder to move between the repos. It will necessarily result in more complexity. Also, the deploy procedure gets harder. Normally, when you want to deploy a front end, it might be as easy as just merging some code to master and maybe running some deploy command, or maybe it even deploys automatically on master merge. But with this NPM package approach, you first need to release new versions of the packages and then update them at the use sites where you use them. And also, while you develop mostly in your own dev environment, the like integration point becomes the weak point. It is possible that you make some changes to your code in your bubble and it looks great, and then you push it to the main front end and everything breaks. So there needs to be good automated testing at the integration point to ensure that the application keeps working. And related to this, there might also be some global state from the main application leaking into the component, depending on how you've implemented things. For us, this has mostly been some old global styles that have messed up our application. So in the storybook, everything looked great. Then we embedded to the main front end and everything looks like crap. So yeah, we've looked at Shadow DOM as a potential fix for this. So you could mount the video editor component under the Shadow DOM and then it would be completely isolated from the rest of the world. Also, of course, when every team has lots of power to choose their own libraries, it is possible that you'll end up including tons of them without other teams knowing, and that might result in your bundle sizes exploding. So you need to be careful with that. All right, to recap, we at Smartly, or at least at the video editor team, have felt that this has been a great choice for us, as it has allowed us to move really fast compared to working on the large front end. And it also allowed us to experiment with new technologies like TypeScript and some like lenses, which weren't that great of a choice, but at least it didn't affect the other teams. And it has also allowed us to build really strong ownership of the whole repository, which is great. And we have, like I said, we have currently split off the UI repo and the video editor, but we are also planning to split off some other things soon. I've been hearing some talk about splitting our Pinterest-related components, and I hear that they are going to use GraphQL there, so that's more of that experimenting. And yeah, it still requires some tooling. For example, with the deploying, it is surprisingly much overhead that if you have to manually release the package and update and make PRs and merge those. So we are planning on implementing some tooling that you could just run one command that does all of that. And that would pretty much fix our issues with the deploying. All right, that's about it. Thank you. Now we have some time for questions. I'm not sure what the procedure is.
Yes, ask questions.
Yes. Sure. Do you want the mic or no?
Give the other mic. Just throw
it. Yeah. Is this on?
This
no.
Controller.
Can you?
Strobe or once. It's a boom.
So you said do you have an Express backend or something like that?
We have a Koa backend.
Okay. So do you use the library you said IOTS?
Not yet, unfortunately. I said that we might be taking that into use in the future.
Okay, because I was interested in how do you like validate the request of that backend, whatever you're using in a sense.
What do you mean by validate?
Like for example, if you, let's say you have an endpoint login and then you have user and password, you want to validate that username doesn't have numbers or whatever. Like, you know, validate
yeah,
the request.
Yeah, yeah. Well, TypeScript type system doesn't really support that kind of thing since there's no dependent types. So what I mostly meant about that with that was that you can validate that we in this case only like do CRUD actions on templates. So we might create a template or an update a video template. So we could validate that it's basically just like a schema, but you don't have to separately define the type and the schema. You can derive the schema from the type. So it's pretty cool, but we haven't looked into it that much yet.
You're talking about the IOTS,
yes.
Okay. Good. All right. Anyone else?
Yeah, just a small question. Rendering, how many seconds does it have to render 1 second of video?
Well, it depends a lot. If it's some really, really simple template which just has like divs moving around, it might take like 20 milliseconds per frame, so that's pretty acceptable. But if it has some 4K Netflix videos on it, video elements, then it might take like, I don't know, a second per frame. So it's quite a drastic difference, and that's definitely something that we are looking for solutions in the future. We have been thinking about either patching Chrome itself, because obviously Chrome can render video faster than 1 second, so there shouldn't really be a reason why you can't do that also. Or then we could not run Chrome in headless mode and instead run it in headful mode, and it would write the rendered data into a virtual frame buffer, and then we could read from that directly, so there would be no screenshotting stage anymore. But like I said, it hasn't been a scaling issue for us so far. We can still scale a lot horizontally, and it's still profitable for us.
Anyone else?
Nice project. Did you guys ever consider the architecture of using projects in different repositories and link them as Git submodules?
No, not really. Or at least I haven't been part of those discussions. I guess you get like, at least you get versioning for free with this, since you have the versions in the NPM repo. You don't need to like figure out how you're going to do that.
I don't know if I got it right from what you were explaining, but apparently different CIs and different build pipelines are required for different learning packages in single monorepo.
No. In the monorepo, you in the learner multi-repo, we have just one CI. But if you had like multiple multi-repos, then you would require basically like one CI for GitHub process, or like, well, you don't strictly require that. I'm sure you can figure out some way to use the same CI jobs for different repos if you want to, but this is has been the simplest way for us.
Just another quick question, since the mic is in my hands.
Sure.
Do you guys have any kind of challenge in terms of doing integration tests between different learning projects that you have?
Well, like us, we are still in quite early stages when it comes to like the amount of different modules that we have. We only have the video editor as of now, so we've been doing pretty basic testing. So in general, we test on the video editor side, and then we just test that it, you know, mounts properly in the like integration point.
Yeah, I mean, what I was trying to express is that you usually mock the dependencies for actually learn packages, or you try to do actual integration tests for
people. No, we don't currently do like integration testing for like with a real backend or anything like that, if that's what you're asking.
Okay,
thanks.
Okay, if there is a very fast question, then not
long, but fast.
Yeah.
Is this editor working in mobile?
Well, considering that the editor only works in the latest version of Chrome, I'm going to have to say no.
Okay, yes. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.